Amém. Thank you, Lord, for incarnating what we've just heard, for coming down to show what love is really about. Thank you for your example that inspires us and motivates us and gives us the strength to imitate you, to be also a sign of hope for many in our world today. Help us, Holy Spirit, to listen to your voice through the sharing, but especially through the time of silent prayer, to let you move us wherever you want us to go. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Father, Holy Spirit, amen. Very good. So, in the second part, we wanted to share about concrete ways to love during this lockdown. Hopefully, it won't last too long. Hopefully, in October, we will have a retreat in person. Let's pray for that. But in the meanwhile, we are still quite locked up, so we can still learn quite a bit about loving in these special conditions. So we will pray now with the passage of the Good Samaritan. We heard this passage many times. I prayed and heard it so many times, but the beauty of the Word of God is that we can always find something new if we are attentive, if we are open, if we look for especially the help of the Holy Spirit in a humble way. He will tell us what we need in this moment, in this stage of our lives. So it's from Luke 10, 25, 37. We will put it in the chat later. But anyway, I read the first bit and then the other part. So it says, now a lawyer stood up and to test Jesus asked, Master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? He replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. Sorry, and your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said to him, you have answered right. Do this and life is yours. But the man was anxious to justify himself and said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? So I will stop firstly on this first bit. So as Steve was mentioning before, loving is something essential. So it's the condition to going to heaven, apparently, according to what Jesus is saying here. He's answering to this man who was worried about how to inherit eternal life. And Jesus gives this answer, basically, that you need to love God and to love your neighbor. And life will be yours, he says to this man, when we put it into practice. I think the problem of this man was that he knew the theory, he knew about the law, he knew the Bible, as we do, but he didn't really want to commit himself, apparently, because he tries to justify himself, who is my neighbor, how can I do that? But in a way that he wanted to test Jesus somehow. But Jesus invites us to find life, to find happiness, to start eternal life here when we put all this into practice. He tells this parable of the Good Samaritan. So I read it out. The most important thing is to read by ourselves, but it's very nice to see all the details that Jesus tells, which are not a coincidence, none of them. So he says, a man was once on his way down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell into the hands of bandits. They stripped him, beat him, and then made off, leaving him half dead. Now a priest happened to be traveling down the same road, but when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. In the same way, a Levite who came to the place saw him and passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan traveler who came on him was moved with compassion when he saw him. He went up to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them. He then lifted him unto his own mount and took him to an inn and looked after him. Next day, he took out 2 denarii and handed them to the innkeeper and said, "Look after him, and on my way back, I will make good any extra expense you have." Which of these 3 do you think proved himself a neighbor to the man who fell into the bandits' hands? He replied, "The one who showed pity towards him." Jesus said to him, "Go and do the same yourself." So in this parable, we can see, first of all, the situation of our world, which is quite a bit like this poor man in the street, beaten, wounded, half dead. We can see the situation of our world. This COVID pandemic has really changed the world, and people are suffering in many different ways. As we know, there are people who literally died, many, and there are countries which are much more unfortunate than us. I was talking with someone from Latin America recently, from Nicaragua, and he was telling me how bad the healthcare is there, and so many people who literally die in the street because of COVID, also because of other reasons, but it's the reality we have now. In Australia, maybe compared to other countries, not so many people died, even though also there are now quite a few deaths too. But we know that apart from that, we have, apart from the disease, physical disease, we also have lots of other consequences. So we have lots of people with mental problem issues, people who lost their jobs, many, many things that we didn't expect. And I don't know, a couple of years ago, nobody would have expected something like that. But this is the reality of our life. We don't know. We can have tests in our lives in an unexpected way. Like this man was a normal man. He was walking in the street and all of a sudden was attacked. So our lives can be like that. We can have different blows in our lives, not only COVID, other things too. And we can end up in quite bad conditions. So we can protest, maybe we can ask God, why did you allow all this? Why this happened? And we can be like paralyzed by the suffering, by the situation. I don't know, by the news. I still watch the news, but sometimes you wouldn't like to watch them because they're quite depressing. Yeah, we can just stop and cry. It's good also for sure to have compassion towards people as this good Samaritan had. But at the same time, we can do something. That is what God is asking us in this moment, to give him a hand and to do something to meet this person, to not pass by. So we saw here the attitude of these 2 religious people, the priest first, and then the Levite. The Levite was a sort of seminarian or something like that, or altar server. So we can all identify ourselves with those 2 characters. like more religious people. I think most of who are here are quite involved in a way or another in the church. So these two characters, the Levite and the priest, saw the man. They really saw him. The gospel says that. So they knew the situation of this man, but they remained in their own world. They didn't want to commit themselves. They didn't want to change their plans, probably their schedule. Maybe they had prayers to say. I'm talking about the priest especially. Maybe we had other things to do. Or maybe they tried to justify themselves. Maybe he's an homeless who doesn't want to work. Maybe he's dangerous to touch him, especially these days we can't touch anybody. So we can find different justifications not to be committed to someone in need. But Jesus invites us to another kind of love. So he invites us to go beyond our little world, to go out of ourselves and to meet others. So I wanted to read you a commentary about this parable I found in Dietrich Bonhoeffer. I don't know if I pronounce it well. He's a German theologian. Actually, he's Lutheran, but he has very, very spiritual books. And one of them is about fraternity. So he comments this passage in this way. We must be ready to allow ourselves to be interrupted by God. God will be constantly crossing our paths and canceling our plans by sending us people with claims and petitions. We may pass them by, preoccupied with our more important tasks, as the priest passed by the man who had fallen among thieves, perhaps reading the Bible. When we do that, we pass by the visible sign of the cross, raised athwart our path to show us that not our way, but God's way must be done. It is a strange fact that Christians and even ministers frequently consider their work so important and urgent that they will allow nothing to disturb them. They think they are doing God a service in this, but actually they are disdaining God's crooked yet straight path. They do not want a life that is crossed and balked, but it is part of the discipline of humility that we must not spare our hand where it can perform a service, and that we do not assume that our schedule is our own to manage, but allow it to be arranged by God. So I think this is a way we can love in this lockdown. Instead of complaining, we can do something. I'm very grateful to Father Greg. I don't want to praise him. I don't know if he's listening to the talk or not, but I think he had a very good idea to start distributing the communion to the people. I know other people, other priests even, well, I don't want to judge anybody, but are complaining all the time, the government and all that. It could be the government is very secular and all that. But instead of complaining, we can do something. So Father Greg had this brilliant idea from the Holy Spirit, I think, as the churches are closed at the moment, we can go to the people and give them the communion. And I can tell you that for us priests, it has been quite a change of schedule. So we don't have such a fixed timetable as before. Every day some new people show up, we have to go to visit, and sometimes people are not there. We have to change a lot of things. We also have our Zoom meetings like this one, like others. I don't know, at uni have a few Zoom meetings. But I'm really enjoying this time because God, he's changing all my schedule. I'm sure he's doing the same with Father Steve and Father Dan. And he's teaching us to love in a real way and to pray in a real way. We can We can pray stopping as we are doing now, and we need that for sure. We need times apart to pray. But our prayer doesn't make sense, is not authentic if it doesn't change our hearts and if it doesn't make us compassionate, like this Samaritan. And I will talk about the Samaritan man, because the Samaritan man, I think many of you know, the Samaritans were also religious, but they were like heretics for the Jews. So he had another way of praising God and other places of worship and all that. But this good Samaritan understood what faith was about more than the official priest and Levite, because he also saw the man in the street, but he was moved with compassion, unlike the other two. So his heart was full of compassion, of sensitivity, of mercy. And that is what we have to ask Jesus for in this moment, for a heart full of this real love, not a theoretical love, not only a love when we are comfortable with, as Steve also was mentioning, with people we like, a love which is always available for others, because we see the needs, the wounds of others. And only prayer can do that. It's not only something we can make our efforts for. It's really God who can transform us. But our prayer will become something vital, not only a duty, not only some formulas to recite. It will be something we need from the bottom of our hearts. I remember when our founder, Jaime Bonetto, the Vermont community, when he talked to some families with many kids, they used to pray a lot before they had their kids. And then their timetable, everything was shaken up. And so he said to them, I remember to a young couple, pray with your baby in the crib. See Jesus in him. And I think we should learn, maybe I'm talking about myself, I don't know, we should learn to see Jesus in others much more. Because, yeah, we see Jesus in the Eucharist, which is good. Now we can't see much Jesus in the Eucharist, and we need him for sure. We can see Jesus in our prayer, but how much do we see Jesus in others? And how much do we pray the whole day? Because it's true, it's not easy to love, as Father Steve was mentioning, universally, unconditionally, and sacrificially, and all that. I find myself asking the Lord in my heart all the time, Jesus, help me to love this person, help me to forgive, help me to bear this person when I can't stand someone. And only Jesus can deeply transform our hearts, and we will become like this good Samaritan, a person who stops and does something concretely for the person in need. So we read in the verses 34, 35, how this Samaritan does a lot of things. He bandages the wounds, he pours oil and wine, he puts this person on his donkey. So he's very careful, very, very attentive. He takes care of all the detail. So he wants to heal the wounds, first of all. He puts oil and wine, which are in the Bible, in other passages, are the symbols of light and joy. So this is not by chance. And then he gives him his donkey, who was or horse or whatever. So it was his means of transport, but he gives it to this man. Then he leads this man to the inn. So it's also an image of the church. We are called to commit ourselves completely to the person that the Lord puts on our path, but then we can also ask for help in the church, in the community. So this is my thoughts, also some Holy Father's thoughts, but each one of you can surely find much more in this passage. But again, the most important thing is to understand that we can do a lot in this time of lockdown for others. And it's the best opportunity we have to love. We hopefully are going to come back to normal life. I don't know how long it will take, when it will be completely normal, but we don't have to wait for that. We can start loving now. And we can take advantage a lot of that. I know that many of you are at home with your family, with your kids, with homeschooling, all one on top of another. In some houses I visited, I know that there is a big crowd there. So it's not always easy, but it's really a good opportunity to deepen our relationships as families, to reconcile things that maybe weren't reconciled. We can maybe have more clashes, but then we can also reconcile ourselves deeper. So it's really a good opportunity that the Lord is giving us to get to know each other much better. The first neighbor is surely our family. I'm talking about myself as well. My brothers in community are my first neighbors. I have to be worried about, who I have to take care of first of all. And then there are many, many other ways we can help others. There are material things we can give others. Also, I think many of you heard how Father Greg wants also to, or started basically already a soup kitchen based on Our Lady Queen of Peace for the poor of the area. Probably there will be more and more in this difficult time. And that is another beautiful opportunity to help out. But we can also help people in a spiritual way, not in an abstract way, in a very concrete way, because everybody needs to have this treasure, to discover this treasure of the faith. As we mentioned before, a very trendy topic these days is mental health. We heard this expression on TV all the time, or in newspapers. At uni as well, they are giving, where I'm working, there are a lot of talks about mental health. And people need this peace in the end, this peace in their hearts, this reconciliation, this purpose of life. Otherwise, as we said, they can have everything materially, but they can be very distressed, very, very sad inside. I can tell that also from my own experience or from my family. I was very disappointed saddened by the news that two of my nieces, I've got seven nephews and nieces in total, two of my young, they're all young, girls and boys, two of them are having problems of depression because of COVID, of the long lockdown. But not only that, it's a problem that has been there for a while. And I know especially one of them is quite far from the faith. And I'm trying now to get in touch with them, with my sister especially. One of my sisters, thank God, came back to the faith during the pandemic. She found again her faith, and now she's trying to transmit it also to her children, because she understands that it's the only thing that can really help them. It's we need also psychologists sometimes, and psychiatrists, I don't know, but really only God can give us the deepest answers. He can heal the deepest wounds we have. So a way we can really love others is by transmitting the faith to them. And we can do that in different ways. Maybe now we can't visit everybody. We can't visit almost anybody, basically. But we can call. I've been calling quite a few people during this lockdown to find out how they were, especially people who were alone. I did many phone calls. We can message people. We can send good material. The internet is a very good gift. We can use it well. We all, or many of us who are in the chat, in the WhatsApp chat, we saw how incredible is everything that happened with Carolina, this young mother who lost her child, unfortunately, just born. But she's from Melbourne, so she found out about us through the internet, and everybody supported her so much, and in the end they sent her a bouquet of flowers and a card and many things. So we can do a lot, even though we are in lockdown for the moment, but love is creative and we can find many ways to reach out to other people, and especially we can transmit to them the faith, which is the biggest treasure we have found. So these are some of the things we can think about. When we can't do more, when we feel helpless, I sometimes feel like that with so many situations, with people who are far away, like my family. I know I can pray for them. I can offer the masses for them. And this is very important too. We don't have to underestimate the power of the prayer of intercession. I've also visited many elderly people who are quite sick, who can't do anything else than pray, really, and watching the masses and the rosaries. But who knows, their pure faith and love can reach out to many more people than we can think. So we can pray for many people, especially in this difficult time. We are called to pray much more intensely, with much more love for others. Again, not only as a formal thing, because we know that only God can give the light and the consolation the person needs. Only God can touch the hearts of the people who need him so much, who are far from him. So we can ask the Lord, how can I be the neighbor of the people in need I meet? Because that is what Jesus tells the lawyer, be the neighbor yourself to others. And just to conclude, also another passage similar to the one we read before, it's John 15, 12, 13, also from the speech of the Last Supper. So Jesus says, "This is my commandment, love one another as I have loved you. No one can have greater love than to lay down his life for his friends." So we can read again this passage and also the parable of the Good Samaritan, and we can see Jesus as the Good Samaritan. He did all these gestures of love with each one of us. He saved us when we were in the street, when we were wounded, when we were in need of everything. He saved us, maybe through other people. We can't forget that it's Jesus, the Good Samaritan of our lives. And now he calls us to do the same with others who want find him if it's not through us, if it's not through the love, the real love we will show them. So let's ask Jesus to help us to imitate him, to be able also to sacrifice ourselves, to give our lives for others. As this good Samaritan, he gave everything without sparing anything for this poor man in the street. Let's ask Jesus, let's ask the Holy Spirit to help us to love in this total way without deserving anything. So now it's time is now.
It's about 4 o'clock, so okay. Maybe we can meet back at 4:30.
Mm-hmm.
We can have